Hi, everyone.
Hi.
I've asked for the light to be kept on because being deaf, if you are sat there in the dark and you make a noise, I would have no idea. I like to see the audience. And I also need to warn you that there is Stephen. Stephen's my interpreter. If he overhears any conversations from you, he will tell me and I will tell everybody else.
Yay.
Okay, so there are not... Okay, whose secrets do you want to know? Point them out, and Stephen can move. Right, so, I'm Paul. I'm 55, but hopefully I don't behave like it. And I have a problem, in that I am profoundly deaf, but people don't believe it. When I meet hearing people, they say, well, you can't be deaf because you talk so well. And I talk a lot. I don't sign all the time. Word of warning, never, ever... stand next to a deaf person who is signing and holding a drink. Yeah, got it, you'll get wet. And then hearing people also say, I can't be deaf because I'm a musician. That's what they think. Then I meet deaf people, they say exactly the same. Oh no, shouldn't talk. Should sign all the time and can't be a musician. So half the population pulls me one way, the other half pulls me the other. But what I always say to people is I'm a person in my own right, with my own way of speaking, thinking, and doing things. And if you've got a problem, tough. I can't be anything other than I am. And if you don't like it, tough. That's one of the most useful signs you can take away tonight. Have you got that one, Michael? Okay, right. I'm not going to make a list of all the signs I do tonight that you don't know. I'm going to test you later. Yeah, Michael made the mistake of finger spelling to me before we started. Yeah, so I'm going to watch you. Stephen, you can have a break now. If you have been spending this hour to be serious, you are in the wrong place. There will be some audience participation. There may be even some rude signs, you never know. And hopefully you will have some fun. So, question. How many of you are musicians? Yeah, don't be shy. This is not like an Alcoholics Anonymous meeting. No, you can actually say. So quite a few. Can any of you people explain to me, deaf person, what this thing is that you do called music? Anyone? If you shout it out, Stephen will interpret. I'm not ignoring you, I'm just getting the information. Okay, so, anybody? Sound. But is it a specific sort of sound? For example, is a car engine or a washing machine music? A nice sound. So if I were to sing, you would agree that that is music? No, because you've never heard me sing. Harmony, okay? Anything else? What does this music consist of? Notes. Yeah, okay. Anything else? Pattern, okay. I'm assuming, and it's always dangerous to assume, that because... Silence. Yeah, I think everybody got that one right. Judging by the pause before there was an answer. I assume that most of you have never actually stopped and thought about it. And that's true for most people in society. Music is something that we are aware of from a very young age. We grow up being surrounded by it. And for most people, it goes in one ear and it goes out the other. And they never actually stop and think about what it consists of. So when they meet a deaf person, or someone who can't hear, their reaction tends to be, what? I could talk to you for hours, but I won't, about music being melody, harmony, rhythm, form, pitch, duration, vibration. I could talk about it in scientific terms, in terms of colour, or in terms of emotion. And all that would happen is that you'll get bored stiff. Because in my view, music isn't something you talk about, it's something that you do. Either by yourself, or you experience it live or recorded. And through that exposure, you have this reaction, which is positive or negative. But it's hardly ever right or wrong, because we are all different individuals with our taste, likes, and dislikes. So, I'm going to play a little game with you. I'm going to clap a rhythm, and you are invited to clap it back. Okay? Are you going to lead by example, headmaster?
I am.
Good. I'm watching you very carefully. No, I haven't started yet, okay. Right, here we go, me first. Go. Yeah, Stephen and I are impressed. Most people with that one go. So, you are the first group this year probably to get that right. Now, I have a rule. But to make this more fun, I'm not going to tell you the rule. I'm going to sign the rule. Do not tell people what the rule is, okay? If I see your mouth move, you will have to go and sit by the head. All right? He says no. Mm. Oh, she says over that. Oh, she's got it. All right. Yeah, 3 claps, do not clap. Right. I have to try and catch you out. Right. 3 claps, don't clap. No, got it. 3. Right. Here we go. Hands out. Can you give me a wave? Bigger wave. Oh, that's a nice breeze. Off we go. Go! Did you clap? Ah! Oh! Right, the headmaster clapped. All right, so that's 1 point to me, no points to you. Right, a reminder, 3 clap, no. If you have problems, there are probably some maths teachers around the school who can help you. There may even be a former history teacher who can help you. All right, let's try again. Nope. I think there's going to be a special prize tonight. Oh. I will help you. All right. Does he need help?
Yes.
Okay. Oh. You can all join in though. All right. Right. Watch carefully. You please clap. Me Phil. Can you see where this is going? Okay, what comes next?
3.
I'm in charge here, not you, okay? Right. Yeah, got it. How did he get the job? Let's just try one more. At the moment, the score is 10 for the score now, Paul 3. All right, one more time. Well, tell somebody. That's all right, I'll let you off. It's his influence, that's what it is. If you want to succeed, move. Well, that might work. Thank you for joining in. The reason I did that was if you are doing music with deaf people, and I'm not saying that you are deaf, I fully appreciate that if you have a boyfriend, then the boyfriend suffers from severe selective deafness. We know this happens, but I'm not saying that you... Maybe you are, I don't know. But if you're doing music with deaf people, you have to make it visual and you have to make it physical. And with that game, you didn't need to hear. All you had to do was watch, remember the rules, remember the rhythm. And when you went wrong, it made it more fun for me. So here end the audience participation part 1. There will be more later. Bit of background. I'm from Yorkshire. Been a while to get going, but yeah, from Yorkshire. I'm actually from Huddersfield, which, as some of you may know, has a silent H. Huddersfield. Yeah, it's got an H at the beginning. I can see you thinking Huddersfield. It's also got a rubbish football team. I now live in Halifax. If you're interested in sign language, the sign for Huddersfield is that. I've no idea why everybody else just does that. Got it? All right. I was born deaf. I've never in my life heard a full piano keyboard. I've never heard birds sing. And I have never heard bagpipes, which I'm actually very grateful for. My hearing loss was caused by premature birth, lack of oxygen and jaundice. And my parents were actually told that I was dead, not deaf. There's an important distinction there. D-F, okay? Deaf, no. Yeah, dead, no. And so I've always worn hearing aids. And I'm still coping without sound. What I find is a bigger problem is my eyesight. Because if I take my glasses off, I really am deaf. Because I can't see to hear anything. Because I can't see to lip read. And I can't see any sign language. Has anyone here any idea what percentage of English is lip readable? 60. Lower. 30. Who said 30? Ah, you're right in front of me. I never heard you. Fun of that, isn't it? Yeah. Try again. What did he say? Okay, yeah. It is actually 30%. You can't, as a deaf person, walk into the middle of a group of people and follow a conversation. You've always got to be there from the beginning, or you've got to be very sly and manipulate the entire conversation so you know what's going on. It's very, very hard lip reading people with beards. Yeah, of one over there. But as I pointed out to Mr. Marriott earlier, it's okay with him because you can see his top lip. But from people who've got really straggly beards, you can't understand them at all. It's very difficult lip reading people who have got no teeth. And it's also very wet when you get close to them. Yeah, don't try this one. It's really difficult trying to lip read people who've been drinking or eating spicy food. But it's just very difficult to lip read anyway. Michael, can I borrow you, please? I'm taking that as a yes. His face will be like, oh. Yes, a pause for Michael. Come on. Don't be worried,
yeah.
But you might be. But if I want to lip read without my glasses, I have to get this close. Yeah. Hello. He stood back, didn't he? All right. Talk.
Yeah.
I'll say more than that.
No, I don't know what I should say.
You don't know what to say. Just say anything,
yeah.
Really, it doesn't matter.
I had spotted dick for lunch.
Can you sign that for everybody? I've kept on repeating that because I was also trying to work out what you had for dinner,
yeah.
But it didn't work. But as you can say, lip reading this close like is quite intimidating. But I'll let you go and sit back down there now. Thank you, Michael. Michael with his famous spotted dick. Thank you very much indeed. If anyone wants to know the sign, ask Stephen later. They won't do that. When I was 5, I decided that I wanted to learn to play the piano. And no one in the family thought this was strange, but trying to find a piano teacher was rather difficult. My mum did not exactly inspire confidence, because she would ring up prospective teachers and go, "Hello, hello there. My son's 5. He wants to learn to play the piano, but unfortunately, he can't hear what he's playing, and he can't hear what you're saying to him either. So, would you like to teach him?" Hello? It's not the best way to approach a possible teacher. Eventually, I found a teacher. A couple of years later, joined the choir, and through that, became interested in the organ. And around about the same time, decided that when I grew up, which was a work in progress, I wanted to find some way of helping other deaf people and those who live and work with them get involved in music. But before that, I wanted to go to university and get a music degree. Back in the early 80s, the only university in Britain to support deaf students was Durham. Can anybody tell me why that might be the sign for Durham? Geography lesson. Sorry, what was that, Stephen? Romans? Dinosaurs? What did they teach you here? Dinosaurs in Durham. Is that what it sounded like? Is that what it sounded like? Somebody else just said dinosaur. No. Huh?
Is it a symbol of the griffin or whatever, the symbol of the university?
No. No, it's a good guess, Headmaster. That's very good. Round of applause for the headmaster of the temple. Very good, very good. But it was not correct. No. That's the thing for Durham because of the castle and the cathedral. Have you got that now? Right. But that's only the sun when you're going north, sir. When you're going south, it's that way round. That's it. Headmaster laughed. As I say, back then it was the only university to support deaf students. They would give you sign language interpreters, they would give you lip speakers, they would give you note takers, they would give you flashing fire alarms, they would give you vibrating alarm clocks. Right. But the one thing they would not give me was a place, because they said, no, deaf people cannot be musicians. Go away and be a plumber or something useful. And it was actually turned down by 12 universities over 2 years, simply because of my deafness. Oh, they also turned me down because they said I do not have a foreign language qualification. Funnily enough, I don't, because when I was at school, we were taught languages in a lab. And if you stick me in a little booth with a pair of headphones on, and you stick in a tape playing French, German, Spanish, Italian, Greek, Latin, Lancastrian, or any other foreign language, A, I can't hear it, and B, you can't lip read it. But there was this feeling that all music doesn't have to have a foreign language. So it didn't look as though I was going to get to university at all. And then one day, Mum found an Oxford prospectus. Now, I hadn't applied to Oxford because I thought, A, you have to be intelligent, and B, if you go to Cambridge, at that time, you had to be gay. It may have changed now, I don't know, but back then. So Mum found this place called Wadham. She liked it. So without even telling me, she rang them up and said, hello, would you like a deaf music student? And they said, yes. So to cut this story very short, I did the entrance exam. I did not have to do the foreign language translation paper. And I was asked to go for an interview. 4 candidates, 1 place. And I thought, no chance. The other 3 could hear. The other 3 could all talk much more properly than what I do. So I thought, they won't have me. But I had my interview, went back to, where's that? Sign language test. Have you got that? I always remember the original sign, too. Oh, have a start. And I got a phone call. I'm not very good on the phone, so my mum answered it, saying, we don't normally ring prospective candidates, but we've decided to ring up and say we will accept Paul next year. So I went to Oxford October 1983, 36 years ago. Had 3 fab years there, and after getting my degree, moved to Manchester. Boo! For a year to do a postgraduate year at the Royal Northern College of Music, which I failed. Luckily, they let me take it again. And this time I passed. Thank you. And I had to start thinking what to do with my life. And what I ended up doing was setting up this charity, the idea of which I had when I was 12. Some way of helping deaf people, those who never worked with them, get involved in music. I mentioned earlier, I asked you earlier what music means to you, and then I gave you a list of all these things. I would hope that the only major difference between you and I is that your ears work better than mine do. You are still bombarded by sound waves and vibrations as I am, but because your ears work, you don't rely on what you feel. I can't just go to a performance, put the radio on, download a piece of music, and work out what's happening. I can't identify what voice is singing, what instrument is being played. I can't pick up the lyrics, melody, harmony, nothing. Music only makes sense to me when I have a score there in front of me. I look at that, and I know in my head exactly what that sounds like. And I think that goes back to being a pianist, because when you press a key down, hammer hits the string, vibrations travel back up your arm, and every note feels different. You know that that note is that one on the treble stave, that is that one on the bass stave. And so it's very easy to relate what you see to what you do and to what you feel. That makes sense. At least I think that's how I do it. To be quite honest, I'm not that bothered. But for 27 years, I've run this charity, travelling around the place, doing music workshops, doing science theatre performances, working with dance companies, opera companies, orchestras, basically anybody who would care to listen. And I would now like a volunteer, please. What? Ah, you are the only person in the entire room to volunteer. Was that you? It was. What is your name?
Well,
are you sure you want to do this well? Tough. Tough. Right, come on, begin for Will. Right. I'll put you there so that if I don't lip with you, I can watch Stephen, okay?
Yep.
Are you musical?
Not really.
No. Never mind, never mind. Don't tell the audience. Can you count to three?
Yeah.
You can count to three, right? But we have got three beats, okay? And we are going to pass them backwards and forward in silence, just using fingers. Okay. Got that? So,
yeah.
I will put one finger up, not that one, one finger up, up well, okay? Well, we'll put two fingers up at me. That's an easier way. If you must. There's a difference between swearing and signing. You can do it that way. So we can work, but you can do it that way, okay? And then I put three up. What comes next? Shh, shh, shh. There'll be three beats. Okay? That, so that's the first level. What you can do, one, two, three, one, two, three. Ready?
Yeah.
Look confident. You're on camera. All right. you're doing so well. All right. Thank you. You're feeling all right?
Yeah.
Do you need water? Do you need alcohol? Right. Now it's your turn. Turn to a neighbour. Right. In silence. Practice doing that. One, two, three, one, two, three, one, two, three. Right. Go! I might be deaf, but I know that wasn't silent, despite what I said. The aim is to actually get that regular pulse going. Some people got it, some people didn't. If you can't do it, slow it down, okay? But that's level one. Will is now going to attempt level two. Now, I have explained to Will what is involved. Got it? Okay.
Yeah.
I don't think it's a dull thud when I hit my head, actually. There's a couple of bars where we go, and it's dead right. Right, so that's level two. You can either clack, click, stamp, whatever. You are not allowed to physically hit your partner. Okay? Try and do it in silence. No, I said no punching, girl. Behave yourself. Oh, off you go, level two. That. Do something different. What do you want? Don't tell me. I'm sure some of you have worked out what comes next. Yes, it's level 3. So I'm going to do that. Will is going to do something completely different. Will has not told me. I hope it's going to be polite.
Yes.
You needed to think about that one, okay? Let's see if you can do it. Right, we're trying to get the put. Think of a pendulum going back and forth. That's the aim, okay? Right. Oh, it's done both now. It's getting me done through this. Would you like Will to try level 4?
Yes.
Can you work out level 4?
Yeah.
Okay. Do you want to go behind the screen? All right. No. That's the first one. All right. Yes, you went out! All right, five, well. That's another game that I often do when I go out working with deaf people. The idea is that you can see a rhythm. You have to react at the same speed it's given to you. But it's also encouraging people to think about sounds they can make with their own body. What I like about about that game is that when you have a large group of people, everybody's coming up with something different. So you can create a very simple but effective piece of body percussion just doing 3 beats. It's also great for teamwork to see how many people can actually keep going at the same speed for as long as possible. And the answer usually is not many. So in 1988, I set up this charity, going out doing workshops, talks, sound theatre performances and so on, which I ran for 27 years. In 2015, I left for various reasons. One was I had depression for the fourth time. And at the same time, 2 weeks later my dad died and my mum had a mild stroke and then she developed dementia. And when I was off work, it was great because I could look after my mum. But then when I went back to work, I found out they had appointed a new administrator who knew nothing at all about deaf people, who knew nothing at all about music, but was obsessed with policies and structures and procedures. And suddenly it was, you can't work with this person, you can't go here, you can't do this, you can't do that. And I thought, hang on, this is my baby. And it got to a point where I thought, I'm leaving. I actually left at the time that I was working in Hong Kong, because starting in 2012, I was working with an orchestra called the Mahler Chamber Orchestra. They are based in Berlin, in Germany. Yes, that is the sign for Germany. Why is that the sign for Germany? History lesson. Yes, sir. Oh, no, tell you what. Let Tom answer. Sorry, Mr. Marriott answer. He is, I believe, a history teacher. And I have been given inside information by another history teaching colleague that he thinks he looks like Henry VIII. It's amazing what you find out over dinner. So, Mr. Mario, Germany, why?
Well, I'm sure I'm going to get it wrong now. But is it from the spike of Prussian helmet in World War
I? A spike on a Prussian helmet. Quite right, thank you. You deserve your job here. The Mahler Chamber Orchestra, based in Berlin, that's the German sign for Berlin. That's my sign for Berlin. And in 2012, they started a three-year project whereby they were playing all the Beethoven piano concertos in various cities around Europe. And they asked me to go along and run some music workshops for deaf kids. So far, we've done 20 different projects in about 12 different countries. Furthest we've been is Hong Kong. We've also done Macau. And 4 years ago, we did a big project in Bonn, Beethoven's birthplace, where we brought together four groups of deaf children from Italy, from Prague, from Dublin, and from Cologne, and had 3 days working with them all together with the orchestra, which was fantastic. Every country has its own individual sign language. It's not universal at all. But what was great was watching these young people getting together and finding not only a commonality through music, but actually through communication. And we're hoping to do a similar project next year because it's Beethoven's 250th. Beethoven has been decomposing for a long time now. Bad joke. That was a bad joke. Don't applaud. It's rubbish. As a deaf musician, this Beethoven anniversary is quite something because people are curious, as you may be, or maybe you're not, as to how deaf people are musicians. As well as a project in Bonn, I've been asked if I'll sign Beethoven 9 at the Barbican in February when they have a weekend, when they've got three orchestras playing all 9 symphonies. Hopefully also doing that in Gateshead, Nottingham, Manchester. And last week I was asked if I would go and speak at some big international youth festival in Vienna in July, which is where Beethoven worked and where Beethoven died. So it's quite exciting. Maybe I'll have to learn German. Or even Austrian, who knows? Just don't look so baffled, it's all right. Now, would you like some more audience participation?
Yes.
God, that was enthusiastic, wasn't it? Let's try again. Would you like to know? That's not... how many of you can sign? No, I know you can. How many of you can sign? Yeah, Stephen, I know you can. Thank God, as my interpreter, you can sign. It helps. Right, I'm going to throw some words out to you, and I would like you please to think of a sign or gesture. Polite ones, all right, linked to these words. First one, cat. There's a very evil looking cat over there. A few of you got it right. That's an ill cat. Right. It's Whiskers. That's a cat. All right. Dead easy one. Elephant. Wrong. Everybody thinks they know that one. We'll come to that one in a minute over there. Right. Elephant is you actually make a trunk like that. Easy one. Prince Charles. Correct. That is actually the sign for Prince Charles. Sign language can be very, very direct, and deaf people have what we call sign names. It is a rule that you never, ever pick your own sign name. It is always something about your look, your character, your personality that becomes your sign name. And the sign that deaf people use for Prince Charles genuinely is Big Ears. So, we now need to find a song that involves a cat, some evil cats, Prince Charles and an elephant. Unfortunately, I don't have any. But I thought it might be entertaining for me, if not for you, to have a go at signing a bit of S Club 7. I'm thinking, who the hell are S Club 7? All right. Have you heard of S Club 7? Oh, you have? Okay. So, what do you know by S Club 7?
Not much.
Did it say 30 again? Not a lot. All right. I will teach you and your colleagues the chorus. Okay? Do you think you can cope with it?
Yeah.
Good. You want to move further back? Good. All right. I'm going to teach you, bring it all back. And people go, what? There's a familiar over there. Hello, recognition, recognition. Is that a no? Right, I'll play a bit of it, all right? See if there's any recognition. By the way, if you can't hear the music at the back, please don't get upset because I can't hear it at the front. And if it's too loud for anybody and you go deaf, I know a man who can help you. Ah, it's this one. Na 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 na. The important thing when you're signing songs is to get the meaning over. It is not word sign, word sign, word sign. That doesn't make any sense. Here's an example. Here's a sentence. The headmaster walked over the bridge. Are you feeling picked on? I hope not.
No, I'm all right.
Oh, good. Good. Wait till you come up here and do the S Club 7 with me, right? Right. So, the headmaster walked over the bridge. I'm going to sign this in English. Which is one sign for one word. The headmaster walked over the bridge. The problem with the headmaster walked over the bridge is that he hasn't actually walked over the bridge. If I do that in BSL, British Sign Language, first of all, I make the bridge. Now, we're not told what the bridge looks like. I've just done a normal arch bridge. And then we have the boss, he is there, and he walks over it. Right? So you're actually painting with your hands what you're talking about. It could be a viaduct. If it was a viaduct, then obviously the headmaster would be walking up some steps of an embankment, and then he will walk across. If he is walking across a rope bridge, he will walk across it rather precariously. If he is walking across the Millennium Bridge over the Thames towards the Tate, which was very wobbly when they first opened it, the head will walk across it. He will stop halfway, go blah, and then continue. Right? So the context is really important. So the chorus of Bring It All Back was like this. Right. Please join in, I will talk you through it. Cross your arms. Right, this is the sign for don't, just uncross them, okay? Do not hit your neighbours, okay? It's weird, isn't it? You say don't hit people, and suddenly, bam, they do it. Oh. Right. No, right. No, stop. So just shut your fingers down. Turn them over, and then give up. Like you're throwing balls in the air, okay? Give up, but then you do never. So, between your, on the outside of your hands, you come down, right, never. So that, no, stop, give up, never. Yeah, if in doubt, just go. Right. Well, that's only four signs, we've got a lot more to go. Don't stop, never give up. Hold your head high and reach the top, thumbs. Hold your head high, be proud, okay? Start it. Yeah, look a bit cocky. Right. You don't do it that many times. Do it twice. Right. Reach the top. One hand up. Finger up. And you aim for it. Okay? Boom. So, don't stop. Never give up. I got it wrong. Don't stop. Don't stop. Never give up. Hold your head high and reach the top. So far, so good. Let the world know what you have got. Hands up. Let the world know what you have got. I translate as, I want attention. Me? Never. All right. So what you do is just turn your fingers out. Yeah. Except that, look at me. All right. Let the world know what you have got. A twat. Let the world know. Yeah. Let the world know what you have got. Problem is when I slow things down, my brain goes, hang on. Oh, never mind. Not the word, no, what? Ah, yes, that's it. Yeah, down there. Is that a bit camp? Not the word, no, what you have got. And then bring it all back to you. That's the first half of the chord. That's where that's probably. Don't stop, never give up. Hold your head high and reach the top. Let the word know what you have got. Bring it all back to you. I'm not quite sure what the boy band of four is doing up there, but. Yeah. It looks good. There's a few additions to it, but you do your own thing. That's fine. That second part of the chorus. Dream of falling in love. Put your hands on your head. Right, this is the annual Canford School Dalek impersonation competition. Right. Open your hands out like that. Okay. That's a vision. It's an idea, and it becomes a vision. All right. Dream of. Stop fighting in the middle. Right. Dream of falling in love. Yeah, as much as that. Dream of. Stop. Sorry, Stephen's heckling me. This is weird. When your sign language interpreter heckles you, it's bizarre because nobody knows apart from the deaf guy. Dream of. Yeah, okay, I've got it wrong. Thank you. If anybody wants to beat him up on the way out, bring it on, he says. Oh, sorry. No, right. Back to that. Dream it up. Right. One figure up. Imagine that is the person that you love, okay? And you go from their head to their toes. If you want, you can do the bottom as well, but you know, straight down, so show it off. So, dream up, falling in love, goes with the beat. Then you do the love bit. And then you do perfect. Towards them. All right. Dream up, falling in love. Anything you've been thinking of. Let the world know what. I've forgotten the words. What are they, Steve? I've forgotten. I'm 55, for goodness sake. Oh, yeah. Let the world. When the world seems to get too tough. Right. Let the fingers out. Right. Turn them around and you bring them towards you like you're criticizing yourself. One, two, and then throw it away. So, one, two, throw it away. Bring it all back to you. Let's try that bit. All right. From the top. Don't stop. Ow. Don't stop. Never give up. Hold your head high and reach the top. Let the world know what you have got. Bring it all back to you. Dream up, falling in love. Anything you've been thinking of. When the world seems to get too tough. Bring it all back to you. I wish every audience was as good as you. But let's try it all the way through. You might want to film the students doing this instead of me. Right. If you don't want to be filmed, put your hand up. I don't. Oh, it's all right. I am being. Right. Here we go. If I go wrong, I take great satisfaction in the fact that you won't have a clue. Because you don't understand sign language. Here we go. Na 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 na. Better. I forgot! Don't stop, never give up. Don't you be high and reach the top. Let the world see what you have got. Bring it all back to you. Dream up, falling in love. Everything you've been thinking of. When the world seems to get too tough. Bring it all back to you. Back on that quick. That was fantastic. Even if you've never sang before, you copied that brilliantly. And for me, as a deaf person who sang, it's absolutely fantastic to watch. It's really, really emotional. So, boom. something from dinner. I've told you a wee bit about me. I've told you a wee bit about my job, that and I work freelance. I've told you about my work abroad. I have complimented the headmaster on being able to count to three. I have complimented Mr. Marriott on knowing that that is a Prussian helmet. You have signed Don't Stop and Never Give Up beautifully. Will has done an amazing job in helping me with my thing, whatever that thing may be. Michael has been the unfortunate recipient of my lip reading skills. But there may be something that I haven't covered, and there's about 5 minutes, 2 minutes, 3 minutes, whatever left. So if anyone's got any questions, lob them gently in my direction. Stephen will catch them and then sign them to me. Go! Michael. sorry, let me do that. Michael!
Can you sign Rat God?
What?
Can you sign Rat God by Eminem?
He can. Yeah, he can. I find it difficult, partly because of the speed of it and being able to follow it. But yeah, talk to this guy. He's probably running out very, very quickly afterwards, but what? Anything else? Ta-da-da. Yep. No, I always wanted to be a musician. Just from the age of about 5, 6, 7, I knew that's what I wanted to do. It's just someone that starts down there, bubbles its way out, and wanted to help other people do it. Never wanted to do anything else. And like most musicians, you do it because you love it. If you get paid, that's nice, but most of the time you do it because you love it. All right? You had a question to... Piano and organ. I'd like to be able to play the cello, but it's not happened yet. And I want to try playing a bassoon, but I'm told my lips are the wrong shape, and the only sound I could make was so I gave that one up.
You said that when you like read music, you can sort of hear it in your head. Does that mean you have perfect pitch?
I don't have perfect pitch. I have what I call imperfect perfect pitch. Because I spent so long when I was young playing the piano that I had at home, I found that rate of tuning kind of got fixed in me. And so if I ever tried singing with another piano or I played another piano, it always felt slightly out of tune. It meant my body kind of resonated in sympathy with it. Does that make sense? As time's gone on, I have a very secure sense of pitch, but it's definitely not perfect. I think living with perfect pitch must be a nightmare. It really must. Better switch off. You can. Any more? Hello?
How can you find the pitch if I've never heard it?
Sorry, how can you find a pitch?
It goes back to what I said about playing the piano. But when you press that key down, you feel the hammer hit the string. Every single note feels different. And so you get used to that rate of vibration. And because you spend so long doing it, you just absorb it. Hi.
How did you learn to talk?
I just talk my gob and the sound comes out. I shouldn't talk as well as I do with the hearing loss I've got. If you met my sister Mary, who's also deaf, you know that she's deaf because of her speech. When I was young, I could hear a little bit more than I did now. And all deaf education was oral. There was no sign language. That was banned. And so you had to learn to speak. I've always liked reading. And so from a young age, I've developed this love of language and vocabulary. But if, say, for the last 35, even 40 years, I've come across a word that I am unsure of how to pronounce. I will always try and find another word with the same meaning because I get embarrassed about pronouncing things wrongly. It's stupid, but I do. And I think when it comes to pitch and inflection, because I'm a musician, that has helped. That's so much part of what I do. Okay? Fab.
Hello.
Have you ever taught people music, or deaf people music?
Yeah. I've not had many one-to-one pupils. They tend to be more groups, classes. But like with hearing people, every deaf pupil is different. But some people you can say, right, here's a high note, here's a low note, and then you work inwards. But some people start with one note, work your way outwards. But it's about developing that physical sensation, being able to feel vibrations, know how far up and down something goes. I think it's fundamental for any deaf person who is serious about music to learn to read the stuff. I've had so many deaf kids over the years who have had some form of music education, but they're never taught to read music, which means that when they get home at the end of the day or during the holiday, they can't make music. Because they don't actually have the vocabulary, the notation to be able to do it. Yeah.
Do you get slang inside
that? Yeah, it does. I'm just trying to think of an example. Sign language in... Sorry, we're just having a private discussion. Not about you, about the question. In the same way that people have different accents and they have different slang in different localities, it's exactly the same with sign language. People who are only a few miles apart will often sound quite differently. People in Leeds, for example, sound different from people in Bradford. People in Bournemouth sound different from people in Poole. We have what we call multi-channel sounds, which are not directly translatable. That's one. Can't think of another one. That's another one. Right. That. Now you want to know what they all mean, don't you? Right. That is partly to do with a timeline. In Saturn we have several timelines. Here is one. I'm small and I will grow. This is another one. That's the past. It comes to now and it goes into the future. But if I do that, that means I haven't seen you for a long time. I haven't done that for a long time. So you can have several words, put them together in one sign. That sign can mean something as brilliant. It can also mean something as absolute rubbish. It's either with your facial expression, or it could just be surprised. You can even use it as a swear word, but not tonight. The boss is watching. Okay? Have we got one more? Yes, madam. I have. I worked for a few weeks with students from Henshaw College for the Deaf in Harrogate. And they also had College for the Blind in Harrogate. And they also had some deaf students. And that was fascinating because they had this hands-on experience of music. They could learn certain pitch, so you remembered where the fingers went when they were playing. But my biggest memory of that was there was one student who decided he would draw a portrait of me and sent it to me, and it looks just like me when I was younger, obviously. It's a challenge, but it's great fun. So, it's probably after 8:30. Stephen and I are now driving back to Yorkshire, despite the fact we were invited to come. Have I got any way of summing all of this up? Probably, yeah. Be yourself. I've not always found it easy being me. That's not meant to sound like an apology or an admission of guilt or anything. There are occasions when I do wonder where I fit in because I'm deaf, I'm gay, I'm a musician. And people think, you don't fit any boxes. You don't have to fit any boxes. Your life is yours. You are you. You have your own talents, your own abilities. That's what makes you unique. So, dare to be different. Some of you will be listening to Peter Tatchell tomorrow. He will be more radical than me, I'm sure. But I hope you've enjoyed finding out a wee bit about this strange, deaf, gay Yorkshireman. It's been fantastic watching you doing Don't Stop, Never Give Up. Thank you very much today for having us.
I can add to that. That was an absolutely awesome talk, and I'm sure one that we will all be talking about for a very long time. On behalf of everyone here, I'd like to say an enormous thank you to both Paul and to Stephen for coming and speaking to us this evening. Ladies and gentlemen, one last time, please show our thanks.